So hello everybody, good evening. Hope you're all doing good. Well, we are just 2 days away for one of the largest DevOps virtual conferences happening this year, which is DOPA 2020. So we have sponsored with some esteem companies. A quick look on our sponsors. We have Quality Kiosk as our platinum sponsor. We have pcloudy.com as our gold sponsor. We have iSquare IT as our knowledge partner. We also have sponsored with IOTA Digital, Value Innova, Brio Zinc, Valuable Consulting, and TestSage. So on behalf of Agile Testing Alliance and DevOps Alliance, myself Deepthi, a member of ATA Bangalore chapter, I welcome you all to the pre-conference webinar, The Digital Quality Office. Well, the title itself seems a little different and apt for the current situation during the pandemic, right? So we have Mr. Mehul Haria and Mr. Nilesh Chowdhury from Quality Kiosk to share their perspectives on this topic. We are happy to have you with us for the webinar, sir. We have Mr. Mehul Haria, who is an AVP at Quality Kiosk. He has 13 plus years of experience in IT with focus on automation, RPA, Agile, DevOps, and digital assurance and banking, apart from manufacturing and insurance projects. He has expertise on digital lending, digital banking, core banking, cash management, core insurance projects. He has played multiple roles like automation lead, delivery manager, Agile, DevOps, RPA process consultant, pre-sales lead. He is a keen learner with focus on solution building and customer-centric approach to consulting. Mehul is extremely a humble leader who believes in getting things done, leading by example. A hearty welcome to you, Mehul. I would also like to welcome our second guest for the webinar, which is Mr. Nilesh Chowdhury. He is a principal technical architect at Quality Kiosk. Other than being a DevOps architect, Nilesh's technical expertise lies in the big data. He has worked on modeling the Hadoop Enterprise Data Hub to pull data from 50 plus disparate sources, including structured, unstructured, text, and voice data. He has developed ETL in Hive for discovery layer of Hadoop Enterprise Data Hub Foundation. He has also developed the analytical data model for health and retirement from the operational data model. Nilesh helps in managing hackathons and other technical events in Quality Kiosk and is an avid learner. Welcome, Nilesh. I would request the speakers to take over from here.
Yeah, sure.
Thank you.
Thank you, Deepthi. I would like to welcome you all on this evening today to give us participate in this webinar. So welcome you all, and I'd like to thank DevOps Testing Agile Alliance and DevOps Alliance for giving us this opportunity to host the webinar. So am I audible for everyone?
Yes.
Yes, sure. I'll just share my screen now. Yeah. Yeah, so good evening, everyone. So I just wanted, so this is the first image. So I wanted your views, like, what do you think after seeing this image? I wanted some answers from all of you. Anything in particular? You can see people playing poker or cards on the table.
But participants, what is so... can unmute yourself if you want to answer. So please unmute yourself and answer.
So looks like everybody is having fun. That is one thing for sure.
Sure, correct. That is correct.
Having social.
Yeah, that is correct.
Looks like someone is winning.
And looks like they have money to spend, which is basically extra money.
Correct. That is also correct.
They are minting money.
So what is so exciting about this? Like, everyone loves to participate here.
Hi, Praveen here. Though everyone is trying to play, but everyone among one is generating the money. He's generating the money through this game and the quiz.
Correct, correct. So if you can relate to the current situation, like how all of us are floating in the current situation with the COVID situation that around us. So, and you know, how it is impacting our business. So what I can say is the outcomes that are expected, it is very uncertain. So you don't know who will win. So, I mean, that is what is the most exciting part of this game. I'm sure everybody of us would like to, you know, play such games and win something, because it is always exciting. Every time you want to see that, yeah, if you can win it. Obviously, there is a huge risk and a downside also, but that is what the excitement and uncertainty brings upon. I'm sure you will all must agree with that input. So with that as the background, I would just like to start off the discussion for today's webinar. So myself and Nilesh will be presenting on the digital quality assurance. So we have worked upon a concept on digital quality office. So with the digital trend that is going around in today's days, so we have seen how customers are changing towards their digital journey. So with that in the background and the previous one in terms of uncertainty, I would like to start the today's discussion. So just before starting, I wanted to quickly give a background about Quality Kiosk. Maybe a few minutes I will spend. So we are one of the largest companies with practice on quality assurance. And we have worked around 2,500 plus projects, and we have around a team of 2,000, I think it is 1,400 in this, but currently we have around a team of 2,000 plus people working on only on quality assurance. So that is the key focus area that we have. And so as per the success factors goes, we have zero rollbacks once a release has gone to production. So that is what we boast upon. And these are some of the clients that we are currently working in the different areas in terms of the domains that we just spoke about, in terms of banking and insurance, fintech, and obviously the telecom, automobile, and manufacturing companies. The focus around geographies where we are currently working is in Middle East, that is UAE, the India region. And along with that, the Far East or the Indonesia, Singapore, Malaysia, Philippines. We have our offices in each of these countries, and the core being India. Obviously, the India is the core practice where we have the head office and the center operations. So this is just a short background. And some of the key engagements that we have worked on the digital transformation. So these are some of the key engagements that we have worked in the last many years in terms of the Kotak Bank, or you can say Jio Money, Toyota. We can see some of the logos here. So the most exciting part is we are also working on the latest technologies in terms of data science, IoT for some of the key engagements. You can see blockchain and some of the upcoming technologies in terms of AI and ML. So that is also evolving with many of the customers. And of course, DevOps being and Agile being the core of it, that is the main focus on the digital transformation projects. So with this quick introduction, I think we already saw in the first slide or the image that we all know that uncertainty is almost a certainty now. I mean, with the situation that is going on around, we don't know what is going to happen in the next. So these are some of the major drivers or the major changes that we are seeing in terms of environment, where we already spoke about COVID. A lot of environmental changes are happening in terms of global warming, in terms of some of the cyclones that are coming on. So some of these environmental changes are happening, due to which the uncertainty is almost a certainty now. Some of the geopolitical issues that are happening with the wake of India-China wars or India-China border issues, Brexit that has happened in the last year, US elections, see some of the global events that are happening in this arena. And with that in mind, we are seeing a lot of changes in the business models. For example, a normal retail or a retail shop that was working earlier, now it is all coming up to the modern businesses or the supermarkets or departmental stores. And now with the evolution of COVID, again, that is breaking. And we are having a lot of digital journeys or home deliveries that are happening through the digital channels. So I think business is continuously evolving and the old models or the old school are continuously getting broken and we are evolving with the new models. And recently, of course, we have seen some of the new changes that are happening in terms of contactless delivery or contactless, delivery of the customer experience. For example, you have seen Domino's having a lot of ads these days, assuring of the same experience or the same quality of pizza, but with a contactless delivery. So these are some of the changes that are happening around us. And in terms of technology front, of course, we all are hearing the buzzwords every day in terms of RPA, AI, machine learning, and some of the trends in electric vehicles, quantum computing that is happening. With also with regards to India, how the macroeconomic scenario is changing. With the COVID situation, we are facing a lot of slowdown, as you have seen, and weakening of the manufacturing hubs with some strong stands taken by in the Indian government in terms of trying to manufacture within India. So these are some of the models. So these are some of the issues which we are currently facing. And with that, I think it is important for all of us to respond to this change. And I think that is what we all learn, right? How we change fast, learn fast, fail fast. And that is what is the core of the principles that we are following. So just moving on to the next slide. So yeah, so this is one of the cartoons that I've taken up. Again, I would like to, take upon a few minutes to understand the views from all of you. So what each one of you would understand from this cartoon, if some of you guys can at least provide some inputs, that will be really interesting. So the story is simple, like how the giraffe, the height of giraffe is adapting based on the environment and how it is gradually getting longer, right? And how giraffe is adapting to the current environment. So what does it leave for us? That is to be thought of. So any ideas, any suggestions, any points that you would like to add? Come on, I would like to hear from you. So I want this to be a dialogue rather than a monologue. Because I think at the end of the day, I mean, everybody is stretched out and I don't want this to be a really boring one. So I'd like inputs from all of you.
Guys, feel free to unmute yourself and go ahead and participate.
I think it's more of so you adapt to the change and that becomes your daily routine.
Correct, correct. Absolutely.
That's correct. High target, high challenge, high target. Accordingly, his level is getting tighter. So that way we can achieve something like that.
Correct. That is another interpretation and that is interesting.
So Karthik here, like only way to survive in this world is like to adapt to the environment and the situation.
Correct, correct. So yeah, so I think all of you have rightly said, and I think now we all are adapting to wearing the masks, which we were not earlier used to, or even washing our hands multiple times, which probably required a lot of push or a change. So I think these are simple things, I'm sure, which we all of us have adapted. And I think that is a strength that we have as humans, to adapt. And that is the core strength, I think, which we need to, take up for even our businesses or even the work that we are doing currently. So that is the core message that I think everybody has clearly understood. So that is what I wanted to highlight here. So just moving ahead, so how is the customer changing? So for all of us, I mean, obviously we are trying to deliver some outcomes for our organizations in terms of delivering either a service or either maybe a banking transaction, you know, approving a loan or insurance policy, or for that matter, you know, delivering a customer journey. So changes in behavior, as you saw in the initial slides, has actually led to shift in the cultural norms, how culturally we are adapting now, and how the societal values are changing. So basically, in a traditional organization, we used to see a lot of hierarchy, a lot of silos, and a lot of behavior that were there, which were typical of a traditional organization. But now, with this change, I think, and the background that we have seen, a lot of people are now, or even the organizations are adopting to Agile, and also moving towards DevOps. So that is the core of it. How you are responding to change, how fast you are able to adapt, and how fast you are able to, you know, go through this change. So that is where it is pushing all of us. Either you push yourself, or you will be left out of the race. So I mean, that is the only choice that we have right now. So with this example, I would like to take one example, which was an interesting case. I'm sure few of us, or you might have used. So with Lenskart, you buy your online specs or spectacles or goggles. So they have this very interesting thing where, you know, you bring your camera to the face, you check out, move it to the left, you move it to the right, and then you see how or which specs are, you know, perfectly fitting to you. And accordingly, they deliver the sizes or the accurate specs. So I think that is another important or, you know, innovation which has happened, according to me, where they use some kind of facial recognition capabilities, and also, you know, how they have digitized the way of buying a specs, which we would have probably not thought of. And it has become very, very simple these days. So, and these are how the customer expectations are changing, and this is how the businesses have adopted. So that is another example, and they have obviously used the technology at its core with AI or facial recognition. So according to so in order to change, we need to have those competences built, right? The competences around digital, how we want to go more digital, and obviously availability being an important aspect. So cloud is the only option that we have. You need to have everything available at all the times. And of course, you don't want to have manual processes around it. And you try to have maximum automation and get the value out of automation, either your manual processes, and try to see how we can evolve. And data being the core, either it could be structured or unstructured data that is all available, that will help you to have the power to process all the information. And we are now working in the work from home model, and you know, security is at its core with information security. So these are the major aspects around which I see that we need to build our competences, and that is where the quality will come into picture, because the quality will then be focused on these areas. So this is where it is important to focus upon. So just moving on to the next section. So typically with that background in terms of digitization and the technologies, what we have seen few of our customers, how they approach quality. So some of them are really late in the game with, they are starting off at a very late stage, like they want to start UAT, the build is already there in the UAT. And they ask us, okay, oh, can you start the testing from tomorrow, say? So that is like a very late in the game. They realize that, okay, they want the testing to be done. And that is where, you know, they come up with bringing culture of quality. Or the quality is generally in phases where they have some teams engage for certain phases. Maybe they would involve only us in SIT or a UAT phase, or for that matter, performance testing. So they don't see quality as a holistic view. That is where we see the need to move towards a continuous quality, where quality is just not either a UAT or an SIT or a performance testing or a CX or any other point. It has to be seen from the holistic point of view, right from the day the product backlog is taken into consideration, or right from the way the requirements are being drafted and up to the end, and even in the post-production, that is where the customers would be majorly focusing on. So that is the principle behind which we are working and evolving the quality, not only just after it has gone live, and have the continuous feedback and the customer sentiments that are there. You see a lot of bashing or a lot of feedback that is coming up once an app releases into a Play Store or a mobile app. And that is where the customer sentiment analysis is really important. And to take the feedback back to the testing cycle, that is where the quality is there. So earlier, the quality was centered around in the middle phase, either UAT or SIT. Now, with the evolution of Agile and DevOps, people have started to move a bit left. That is, shifting left. And then the third aspect is on the shifting right, because that is where you will get the maximum benefit. With that in mind, we as an organization are also adopting. So if you know how we were working earlier, so we had these three particular silos or departments that we had there, people working on the only on the pre-production side, only on the SIT or the UAT or the functional testing side, or people who were only focusing on the performance testing, and all the people only working on the post-production or the monitoring side. So now, as an organization, we have also learned a lot, and that is where we feel the silos have to be broken, and we should also have a unified view of quality rather than just working in silos. So that is how, as an organization, we are also changing. So, sorry, just to break a bit of monotone, I had a small quiz for all of you. I'm sure most of you must be aware, but I thought I'll just have some interesting insights from all of you. So if some of you can answer, like, I'm sure you must be aware, what is the CX testing? I've spoken something about that in the earlier slides, but I'm sure you must be aware about it.
Just a small... You can just unmute yourself and answer with the correct option.
Yeah, Karthik here. CX is like graphic, the GUI testing, what the user touches, like clicks, that is like CX, customer experience.
Yeah, that is, I think, partly true.
I would go with the CX testing focus on all interaction customer as with digital applications.
Yeah, correct. So I think that is the right answer. Actually, it is just not about UI UX. So basically, what you said was about testing the UX or the usability of the application, on how the navigation or how the UI is looking and how it is usable. So that is also a part of CX, but that is not just the only focus of CX. Rather than that, it actually interacts with the complete journey. How the journey starts, how the customer, for example, customer wanted to do a transaction, maybe a fund transfer from a mobile app. How does he start the interaction? How does he open an account? Or how does he does the fund transfer? And this is the complete interaction, complete experience, or all what he has with the application, not just the function aspect, not just the usability aspect, but the performance. So these are the other aspects, the network aspect. How does it work in that particular handset, or how does it work in particular mobile? And how does that work in particular geography? For example, if it's working in a remote area, or if it's working in a, urban area. So all these complete aspects put together actually focuses on the CX testing. So, yeah. So I think thanks for responding. So at least, I'm aware. I mean, otherwise, this being a webinar, it becomes actually difficult to check if people are actually with me or, getting lost. It's become difficult for me to identify that. Yeah. So any questions or any other, points or anything that you would like to highlight so far? Anyone?
Participants, if you have any question, please unmute yourself or raise hand, or you can even chat it out.
Hi, this is Vintesh. I have a question. I mean, basically, since we are speaking about adaptability and agility, so can we include two more parameters like trust and respect?
Correct.
With respect to the, you know, testers, you know, because most of the time, whenever they don't have time to do the testing, they either they go with the automation or they go with the reducing the testing cycle because they don't have time. So, right. So how we can say that, you know, testing can also have the, you know, the same kind of respect or the trust what the developers have, because everyone in the team will be focused towards giving the best experience to the customer. So
correct.
So is there anything that they can, we can make them understand the value of testing provided to them, you know, in this agile world, will, you know, will help to some extent that they need to understand the importance of testing as well.
Correct. Absolutely. So I think that's a very valid point. So I'll tell you a couple of cases. So what we have seen is, as I just mentioned in the previous slides, what you have seen is testing is currently treated in silos, or, you know, it is coming in phases or it comes late in the game. Even in the agile, it may not be completely agile. Some of the cases we have seen, it's a hybrid model that people typically follow, where they develop the application or the build, and then it is given to the testing team. So the development will still be agile, but the testing is still working in a scrumfall or a waterfall mode, typically. So here the focus is always for us as a culturally, I think, is more towards the development and not towards the testing side of it. So some, you know, I've read some books and I have seen some of the cases in customer, what they have started doing differently. It's a small cultural change, but it takes a lot of learning and unlearning to be done at our end, where we see that the developers are also included as a part of the overall quality. So where the quality is just not owned by the tester, rather than the quality being owned by the developer, by the tester, by the BA, by the product owner, I mean, whoever are the members of the squad or of the agile team, that is where the culture or the change will come. That is where you will have more trust and respect. Now, even a developer doing a testing, I mean, contributing in testing, that is where he will realize that, yes, the testing is important. And that is where, you know, feedback coming to him from the testing or himself being a part of the testing team, that will, you know, have a lot of trust and respect. That is one angle which I thought could probably, you know, connect. I don't know whether I tried to answer it. I hope that, you know, addresses some part of it.
Yep, that's perfect. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you. Just moving on. So what we have typically seen is on the KPIs. So the KPIs that we have seen earlier, as you can see on the right side, are more towards the productivity. That were the typical KPIs for any digital assurance or any digital application, where they were moving towards the productivity or towards the quality, you know, assurance, or towards the speed, I mean, release the faster time. But slowly, these KPIs are actually turning towards the KPIs that are listed on the left. That is how the digital milestones are getting tracked, or how the digital milestones for a customer journey are getting delivered. What is the business effectiveness of the delivery, and how the digital journey is helping, you know, businesses expand, evolve? It is impacting in a positive way. It is impacting in a negative way, in terms of revenue maybe, or in terms of the number of users getting using the application, or in terms of sentiments. So how it is translating to the business outcomes, that is really more important. And the third being, as we all understand, the automation at its core. Either it could be test automation, or it could be unit automation, unit testing, or it could be on the right side, where you're automating the monitoring, the performance testing, or even the complete DevOps for that matter. So that is where the KPIs have been changing. So this is what we have seen for some of the customers, where traditionally the KPIs that we used to promise were more towards the right hand side. And now we are asking the customers to move towards the left. Of course, with how the customers are adopting, we are also, modifying our KPIs, and we are also trying, if you can, you know, impact on the left hand side. So this is what is a change that is happening in the KPIs also. So now coming to the topic that we had started in terms of the Digital Quality Office, which was the focus of the discussion today. So these are the pillars of the Digital Quality Office. That is what we see. Automation and automation intelligence is the first one, where the focus is not only just doing the automation, but also getting the feedback at the right time, at the right moment, and having a right kind of matrix or right kind of data with which we can actually solve the problems or fix the defects, or you know, make our customer experience even better. So that is what the automation and the automation intelligence is about. Second is, how proactive can we be with the data or with the intelligence that we have? Which are the areas which we need to focus in terms of fixing the issues? How early we can get the feedback in terms of code quality, in terms of unit testing, how it is impacting you know, the overall functionality? So that is where the dashboards or the transparency will be required. And that is where the third point comes, in order to have a unified view of quality. You know, to have the data in development stage, also in the QA stage, or for that matter, the production stage. So it's important to have the unified view of quality and to take that feedback fast. And again, you know, fail fast, learn fast, and I think move on. So that is what the focus would be. So this is what the Digital Quality Office is around. So that is the vision of DQO. So just expanding the previous slide in terms of Digital Quality Office, yeah. So this is what typically we are seeing, right? QA starts at the center most of the cases, but for digital applications, I think it is important that how we can shift left and get the early feedback. So what we have seen is some of the customers, and especially the large banks that we are working with, traditionally, they have really complex architecture and the complex systems. For example, if you want to do a typical payment transaction, maybe in some of the aggregator, it goes through around say 15 to 20 interfaces or interfacing systems or jumps that are there in the backend, the complex architecture that they have. So it's really, you know, that kind of inertia or that kind of change that is required for them, you know, to think that how they can change from QA to a dev QA, that is by shifting left. And also at the same time, how they can get the feedback from the operations QA or from the right side. So so what we are focusing here is QA at the center is already there. We help customers either to move towards the left or the right in order to achieve those KPIs which are there in the earlier, the digital transformation KPIs. And with so I'll just give you a simple example. So what is happening is with some of our customers, I'm sure you must have heard some of the banking that is happening through either WhatsApp, through chat, through IVR. Now the next wave of technology is coming is towards the appless banking, where you know you can bank anywhere or any channel or any link. There is no particular URL or no particular link that you need to go through, but you know, you can just maybe type a text or something over the Google or over some of those links, and you can directly start the banking. So that is the next era of banking that we see moving towards, and it is very exciting. And with that as the focus, what we have seen, the customers are not able to understand, because I'm sure you understand that with the appless banking, you'll not have a particular UI or a particular, you know, application that you need to interact, but it is more about the interfaces or the backend calls or the API calls at a microservices layer that are currently involved in the appless banking. So it's a challenge for customer to understand that the traditional testing that was there in the UI, now that is moving towards the left and which is more focusing on a API layer. So that is where we see that the 80% of the testing has to be done at the API layer, and that is to be done early, and only maybe 15 to 20% of the testing has to be done at the UI layer and at the ops layer. So this is another change that you know, we are seeing. And what we are seeing, the budgets that are shifting from the customers are also coming towards the right, where a lot of ops queue has to be done. So the idea of testing in the production was actually a stigma for even us, like a quality kiosk as an organization. We used to just think that why do you need to test in production? But I think with the current applications that are there and the third party interfaces and the complex architectures that are available, it is very, very important for us to focus the testing even on the right. Maybe as per the some of the surveys that we have seen in the Gartner or some of the Forrester reports, they see that the budget spending will actually increase towards the right, where the focus will be more towards the ops QA and, you know, some kind of new testing techniques like chaos engineering, monkey testing, test ops. That is where the focus will be moving towards. So yeah, so this is what we are trying to say on how the DQ office will be centered around. So I just wanted to bring upon certain challenges that we are seeing in the DQ office for a few of our customers. As I just mentioned in the previous slides, so it is more towards the shift of culture in the quality, which is the prime focus, where the earlier the focus was, as someone highlighted in the question also, the testers are not getting respect or the testing is an afterthought. It has to start from day one. That is what we are seeing the shift. And having a quality governance or having a quality dashboard, that is another change that is there. Typically, what we have seen is the tracking that is done in terms of scheduled timelines and in terms of how we are faring against the plan versus actual. But the quality is not getting tracked in that manner. And also, of course, with this in the place, what we want to move towards is standardizing the quality engineering practices across the end-to-end life cycle. So that is where the culture and the DQO is also moving towards. So these are some of the challenges which we have seen in one of our customers. So this is the case around that. This is a sample working model which we have implemented in a couple of customers that currently we are working in the digital transformation journey, where the DQ office is a squad or it's a team that sits with the outside the squads, or they are governing the overall quality, where the focus is around the strategy, having the right size of people, right size of skills, the structure, defining the right processes and the solutions around it. Obviously, the solutions would be centered around DevOps and a lot of the new age technologies that are there. And the focus is on governance, as I said, in the matrix, the measurement, and how quickly we can provide the feedback. And in order to set up the DQO, training is another important aspect to have the right skill set. And of course, audit, because that is where we are continuously improving and getting the continuous feedback around it. So I've just blurred out certain cases because there's a customer centric information. So at a high level, I mean, these are the right building blocks or the working model for the DQ office. So I'll just move on. At a broad level, what we have seen is the roles and responsibilities or the product structure, how it is evolving. On the left side is where the digital quality office stands. Obviously, they will have the testers or the QA champions that will be part of the squad, and you'll have certain other areas where the DQO will be governing the complete QA, right from the dev QA, the QA and the ops QA. So that is the left side is a sample or an indicative structure that we are working with a couple of customers. On the right side, you can see how the skill sets are changing. For example, a typical manual tester and an automation tester is now, customers are now asking towards the full stack testers. Oh, that why your tester is just able to do automation, or why your tester is just able to do manual testing. So they want the tester of the next generation to have the manual testing, automation testing, as well as some of the capabilities around their DevOps. Maybe they would be able to do performance testing or some bit of security testing. So these are the kind of skills that even the teams that are moving towards full stack that are looking at. Of course, we are all aware that development is also moving towards a full stack development. And with that, the testing is also expected to transform. So the earlier roles and responsibilities, some of the cases what we have seen is people don't even write, log the defects. So that was a typical practice that was followed for, you know, every testing that you do to log a defect. So some of these practices are also getting fine-tuned or getting modified, where the developer and the tester, they sit together and they say, oh, why are you logging a defect? Please don't log a defect. You can fix the defect. And that is where the tester is actually helping and pairing along with the developer, you know, to log the issues and fix the issues at that point of time. So these are some of the small changes that we are seeing that is happening around. And that is the focus of the DQ office. So we help to transform, you know, to the quality assurance practices so that we can handle the digital application of the next. I think we were getting monotonous, so I thought I would have a small quiz around RPA. If participants can unmute themselves and, you know, help me with the right answer.
The correct answer is C, I think.
Correct.
Yeah, it's C.
Yeah, that is correct. So what we have seen is RPA, or the robotic process automation, that was currently being used for the typical business process automation. That is actually, you know, there are some research or the articles even that are there. We are seeing that RPA being currently used for even the testing processes. So the need being that the skill set being the core around it, where traditionally we were seeing that the testers, you know, not so good or not struggling in terms of, you know, coding, or they were so earlier the testing as a career was thought about people who don't understand coding will go for testing. So that was the basic mindset that we had. So with RPA tools that are coming into play picture, it is focusing a lot on the skill set, where, you know, you can have a scriptless kind of tools where it will be much, much easier for you to, you know, work upon the automation and the how quickly we can build the automation scripts, since it has to be, you know, modified with every sprint in the agile. So that is where RPA has been helping. Just moving ahead quickly, to the DQ office, I talked a bit about training. So these are some of the aspects around the training people in terms of, you know, measuring their maturity and their skill indexes, and how we can help them to, you know, move up the curve with the skills that we had seen in the previous slides, with either going towards a full stack testers or a full stack developer, or, you know, handling the overall QA practices. So that is where the training model, which is there in DQ office, that will help them to scale up. Leaving thought from my side, in terms of the overall model, this is what the end state solution that we are currently looking at, with the dev QA practices that are there on the left side, or the ops QA on the right side, and the complete dashboarding and reporting happening. So this is the overall solution or the modeling that we are seeing in terms of managing the overall quality assurance. And this is where we are seeing how the current day engagements are helping towards the digital quality office. So the digital quality office is just not people process. It is also about solutions, the overall skills, and, you know, having a culture of quality. So that is where the focus is of digital quality office. Thank you so much. I think I had some good insights, and I think we will just finish off a couple of slides which we have. I'll ask Nilesh to now pitch in, and, you know, he can present on the overall solution, and then maybe we can have some time for a Q&A.
Mehul, sorry for interruption, when do you want to share the survey? After Nilesh is done?
I think once Nilesh starts off, I think we can, you know, present the survey, and that is fine.
Sure.
So now I think now is the time where you can ask for the survey, and then I think Nilesh can take it up.
Sure. So let me post the link in the chat.
Yeah. Sure. So hi everyone, I would like to take your a few minutes maybe just to get some insights and it will help us to get the feedback on the survey form. So you know that will help us to take some inputs. So Nilesh, you want to take this up?
Yep, perfect. All right. So hi everyone, my name is Nilesh, I'll be talking about the typical platform that we have for digital delivery. So there are a few questions I want to ask, but anyways, we don't have much time for this. So quickly, what are the key aspects of principles behind DevOps? Anyone? So you might have read about DevOps. So what are the principles of DevOps?
Faster time to market.
Okay.
Continuous delivery.
Adapting to change.
Perfect. So, as rightly said, it's more about faster time to market. And this is why Agile and DevOps has come into picture. This is the answer which you may Google what all these things mean. For example, infra as code has some benefits over managing the infra the old way, where I have the infra and my ops team is working on it, developer doesn't know what to do. So it's more about configuring your own infra depending on what your requirement is. Every developer has their own way of deploying the infrastructure and deploying their applications so that they have minimal dependency. So when we talk about Agile and DevOps, I think there is another question, Mehul. Can you when we talk about does Agile replaces DevOps? Is it the same? Is it a replacement? What is it?
No, I don't think Agile would replace DevOps. I think Agile and DevOps are complementary in nature.
Perfect. So how they are complementary? So probably we can have a look in the next slide that's the last slide I have. That's the only slide I have to talk about. Pardon me because it's a very busy slide. Mehul, can we move to the next one?
Yeah, sure.
Okay, so typical delivery pipeline looks like the one that is on the top, where where you see an arrow which says a product delivery. So let's infer from the same examples Mehul has given that banking industry is changing. For example, you had a mobile app and every bank had a mandate that they should have a mobile app to have a larger user base, because no one is going to stand in line to pay their electricity bills. So you have these services, bill pay services on mobile, attached to your bank, so you can quickly debit from your account and pay your bills. But moving ahead, there would be a lot of changes, like using your smart assistants doing that, and that's where the app-less banking come into picture, where you say, Alexa, just pay my bill, pay my electricity bill, or pay my utility bill. So that's where the entire application ecosystem is changing. Obviously, banking operates on a very very old systems, where you have got something like pods, the old banking system. But how would you upgrade us? And this is where microservices came into picture, because that gives you a lot of flexibility. You can write any kind of app over microservices. You can utilize the services as a third party. So let's say if you talk about Google Pay platform, it uses the UPI payment handle which ICICI Bank or maybe Axis Bank provides. So a third party app comes into picture and it says that, hey, I need to use your services, which gives a bank a better exposure to a larger market, a larger user market, right? So that's why applications are coming into more on microservices architecture, where every element, for example, fund transfer or maybe bill payment or maybe payment section are individual features, and they are driven by themselves. They are a separate entity altogether, and they can be integrated with any app or any third party application. So how would you address, how would you come up quickly with such kind of change in your digital strategy with a quicker time to market? And this is where platforms like these would help you, where you have an agile process, which you can see on the first block, where tools like Jira would come into picture, where you have an ideation process, you come up with some use case modeling that, okay, these are the features that we want to expose to the third party applications or external users. Then this entire development is driven into sprints using Eclipse, using Epics and Stories. Now, we talked about an early feedback where we said that shift left and shift right. So what is shift left? Shift left is more about early feedback. How early do you know that your application is even passing? If it even adhere to the standards or the functionalities your BA has defined. So this is where Agile come into picture, which sets the practices that, okay, in the development itself, why can't we have a dev test, something like a dev box, where the dev QA will test on the development box itself. Whenever the code is developed for that story, that particular story, the QA sits with development team or the developer and sees whether is minimal set of use cases are passing or not. So this is an early feedback where you give it to the developer right there when he finishes his code before checking in. So let's say if we are using something like an SCM process, source code management process, where earlier the developer used to complete the story, mera kaam ho gaya, I'm just checking in this code and I'm sending this build. But before that, there is a QA that is happening, and that's where the early feedback comes into picture. Now, when you typically think about a microservice architecture, it's more about collaboration between different teams, and you are separating the team into something like an API team and a UI team, right? A UI development team. So what happens is many a times these teams work in silo. There is actually something called as a API contract happening between these two parties, where they agree on that, okay, this is the API structure. If a UI sends a particular structure of request, this is the way I'm going to get the response, and there should be a defined response structure so that I can design a UI over this response. So, but what happens eventually in practical life is these contracts are not adhered to, or maybe they are too old. The API developers or the producers, what we call, they do the changes without intimating the UI developers. And hota kya hai ki, let's say aaj account number ek numeric value tha, but kal ko wo alphanumeric ho gaya. Usme UI has gone for a toss, because the parser that I have written for UI, it converts it into it, and that's why the integration doesn't work. So how do you deal with this? Would you wait in such kind of faster time to market requirement? Would you wait for an application for a UI developer to check in his code, get into UAD, and then you test the integration? I think not. So, and that's where something like contract test come into picture, where you write these expectations into the unit test itself. So the producer and consumers, like producer will be the API writers and consumers will be the UI writers, UI developers, will have an understanding of unit test code between both the parties, which will ensure whether both the developments are in sync or not. So that's where tools like Pact come into picture, where it gives a broker an interface between these two teams. So whenever the unit test runs, it sees that what is an impact on the UI team. It does an impact analysis and it gives you that, okay, because of your change, these things are going to fail for this team. And that's where the another part of early feedback comes into picture. So shifting left is more about giving an early feedback, where something like DevBox, contract test, and early performance test would help the developer or the product delivery team to get an early feedback. Now if we go towards the QA part, where you see continuous testing, this is where QK has some proprietary tools where we have domain accelerators. So let's say banking domain. we have scenarios, you know, or the rule engines written, which automatically generates the test cases, and it gives the QA team an idea for this particular feature, let's say payment feature. These are the typical use cases you want to test, right? So that nothing gets missed out. And this is where the feature and end-to-end testing comes into picture with the domain accelerators. Moving ahead, you know, on the shifting right thing, where you know, something like performance assurance, observability, and chaos testing comes into picture, where you say that you know, how you can get a feedback, an early feedback, how the application will behave in the actual environment when there is a lot of user load on it. That's where performance and chaos testing comes into picture. So this is, you know, the pre-prod environment we are talking about, where we imitate or we simulate, you know, how the pre-prod environment would look like. And, you know, we run something like a performance test and chaos test. So chaos test is something like, you know, if you have a microservices application, you will have different, you know, deployed on Kubernetes, you will have different nodes. So this test is going to, you know, switch off a node randomly, and it will observe that you know, how your application is behaving. So this is going to happen. This is going to happen in your live environment, in your production environment, when your you know, your server farms are going to go down, or your nodes are going to go down. So in that case, how your application is behaving. So that's where, you know, you test it early in the pre-prod itself, that okay, because of these nodes going down, these are the services impact, and this is the message that we should display, rather than giving some random errors, right? And lastly, the observability, where you know, you collect the data from the prod application itself based on what is the infra usage, what is your application usage, and these analytics go back to your developer saying that, you know, this is the release where I have a high you know, infrastructure user or high CPU user. You need to tune up your services somewhere so that, you know, you can utilize the infra efficiently. So, you know, this is where, you know, we talk about, this is how tooling helps us in getting an early feedback in shift left, and a quick feedback from the customer end in shift right. So, so typical product delivery would look, you know, on the top, you can see the topper line, which talks about unit, smoke, API, UI, regression, sanity, and then to prod. But if you talk about a product quality and how you can shift left and right, this is the downer, the lower, you know, line you can see, where you can see contract test, early PT, performance assurance, and observability. So these are the platforms that QK has, and which helps the you know, client to manage their quality better and get their product you know, faster, or you know, delivered faster to the market with a proper quality. So that's it from my end. I guess we are 1 minute over. Any questions?
Thanks, Nilesh. Yeah. So any questions? Yeah, we would like to have some time for the questions.
Yeah, just like Karthik here, you wanted to know, like, what are like the tools you are using in the like dev QA, like how we can improve this dev QA, how we can improve it through a set of tools or like whatever process or whatever it is. How do we improve it? Like, how you guys are doing it?
Well, ideally it's very simple. We use Jira itself, you know, based on the acceptance criteria. So there are processes. More from the tooling perspective, I would focus on the process where you would have some ceremonies in your agile process, something like a DevBox test, where you don't need any automation. You just need the QA guy to sit with the development dev guy along with the BA to see whether, you know, whether there is any feedback on the story he has developed. So they can write that feedback in the comments itself, that okay, boss, the color doesn't looks good, or maybe your you know, drop down is not showing the necessary you know, values. So these are simple feedbacks that the QA can give in DevBox itself. The developer can fix it in the same day if it's a smaller item. We don't raise a bug for this, right? So it's kind of feedback on your Jira ticket itself. So that's one ceremony. Second is, you know, when you do a smoke test, or maybe exploratory test in dev QA side, you can very well automate it using BDD, where you take the acceptance criteria written by BA and you write your step functions to automate your business driven development. So BDD test is something that can come to help, and for that you can use Cucumber.
Okay, thank you.
Hello.
Yeah,
Abhinav here. So I have a question, like from the QA point of view, the adoption of QA is coupled with the way at the client side or the business is transforming overall in the industry. So any challenges if you see or foresee in terms of adoption or how ready will the client be to implement? Because ours as a QA, some scope is beyond our control. So in terms of the architecture they are deploying or the services they are using and the design. So I will just give an example. For example, in banking, there are some core applications where might the frequency of check-ins will be less for the core banking. Or if you talk about the internet banking or the mobile banking, the code deployments might be at a higher frequency. So is there any strategy at the QA end, like how will you segregate for the different type of applications or anything as such?
So point well brought. Strategy depends upon how your process is, so something like where your code changes are very frequent or your build creation from the dev side is very very frequent, you would put something like dev box or maybe contract test, which is your shift left strategy, so that you identify the QA defects early in the stages. But for something like where the code deployment is very frequent, you would put something like site reliability engineering, where you will have concepts like observability, customer experience. You need to integrate both your ops operations team and your QA and dev team, because the delivery team is runs on in their own silos. Production team runs, or maybe ops team runs in their own silo. So SRE is a concept that binds both of them together, where we teach the operations people how to manage or how to tune up their applications and send the feedback using these tools. So observability is something that would come into a larger play where you have a lot of deployments.
So sorry, just to
add, I hope I'm answering your question.
Just to add to this, so basically for monolithic applications or for the ones which are not changing, maybe the application which you're talking is core banking or core applications. apart from that, you need to decide whether you want to apply the complete lifecycle, whether it's really a need to go complete DevOps, or you want to do it in certain pieces, maybe a post-production loop, maybe a automation. So that is another consideration we need to take into picture, because these applications might not have the high release frequency in terms of changes. So that is another factor that you need to consider while deploying the complete solution.
Okay. Yeah.
Hi Nilesh, Ravi here. Thank you. Thank you for this beautiful slide. Though you said in the early, this is a busy slide, but the way you explained, I think so, the very much all the content is very relevant. So I had one question here. Can we in this complete model, can we is it possible to do only continuous testing without involving the left shift of involving development teams? And if yes, what is the first area that one should focus on? Meaning to start with small pieces if you want to start, and how complex and easy are these tools to run for anyone, like for a normal manual tester? So if you want to start with the only continuous testing, what is the starting point for the teams to start?
Absolutely. So, I mean, in few of our projects, we do recommend where you know, we don't have much influence on the dev side, because if you take a look at this entire model, this is driven through your continuous integration, which in turn triggers your continuous testing and then the deployment. But if you don't have control on continuous integration, what you can do, you can use something like Jenkins. You automate or schedule your jobs. So let's say once you have the build, you may know the frequency of your build. So let's say if it's a nightly build, then you can schedule your regression API UI test or whatever is described over here in QA. You can schedule this on Jenkins, and let's say you can run this on a schedule. So you know that, you know, rose 12 baje, 12 o'clock, you are getting that build. You trigger your scripts at 2 o'clock, and by the morning time, you will get your results. So no one is, you know, spending their time executing it. You have the results in hand, and you do your RCCA in the morning. So that's the quickest way you can achieve continuous testing. Once you are done with this, once you are done with the schedule and you show that you know, there is a value add and I save a lot of time in QA, then you can convince the development team that, you know, why don't you just integrate this process with your CI, where whenever your build comes, my jobs get triggered.
Okay.
I would like to interrupt here for a minute. Thank you guys for all the questions, and thank you Mehul and Nilesh for answering them so elaborately. I'm sure you other participants will also have many more questions, but in the interest of time, because it's already 8:10, can we take it offline? Maybe you can connect with Mehul and Nilesh on LinkedIn. Is that okay, Mehul and Nilesh?
Yeah, sure.
So we had a fantastic 1 hour of webinar. Thank you so much, Mehul and Nilesh, for giving this webinar and your PPT slides. Starting from the uncertainty, which is almost a certainty, into the product delivery plan that we had, we thoroughly enjoyed it, and there was a lot of learning that was wrapped for us in the last 1 hour. Thank you both for being here, and thank you for doing this.
Thank you.
Yes. So guys, please feel free to write to us or connect with Nilesh and Mehul on LinkedIn if you have any more questions. People who have started coming in late or who have not been able to join this webinar, you will all get the links whenever it is ready.
Yeah, to quickly add to Deepthi's point, so there is a survey also which has been prepared by Mehul and Nilesh and the team. So we have just dropped a link in the chat. So if you are yet to fill it, you can please fill it. Over to you, Deepthi.
Sure. Thank you. And this is Aditya here. Thank you, Deepthi, for being such a wonderful host. And I would like to thank both Nilesh and Mehul. A big, big thank you, guys. I think it was really wonderful session. You guys just nailed it very nicely. Some of the latest technology trends that you shared is really humongous. And I think these kind of information sharing will help our audience in a big, big way. I'm sure that there would be many more learnings in the upcoming DOPA. And we really look forward for everybody to join in. It's really a pleasure. Thanks, Deepthi, once again. You did really wonderful well for hosting this webinar for us. Guys, cheers. Thank you so much. Bye for now.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Bye.